First World Order Radio. Finally, we are on the air. No doubt. All right. There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight. First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m. We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet. There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
All right, back once again with Dr. Alim El-Bey. All right, we're going to go into a very good show tonight dealing with ancestral altars and the science of canto magic. Let me bring up my co-host. Brother, are you here?
Good evening, brother. How you doing?
I'm doing well, bro. What's up with you?
I'm doing very well, Moore.
All right, that's good.
All right. Glad to hear from you.
All right, we're going to get things back on track.
All right.
And we're going to be doing this, ancestor altars night and candle magic. So we're going to go into the first part, in which that is dealing with the altars, in which that basically the science of altars, of course, deals with ancestral communion. You know, we need to give honor, you know, to those that are transition, passed on, you know. An altar or shrine must be set up in the memory. Even if you go to China or Japan, they have shrines, our ancestral shrines, set up all the time. And that is something in which that they get from, maybe some of the Kong people, you know, or African, right? So, of course, you know, every person that dies is not considered an ancestor. In most cases, they're just considered a dead relative until those that are living acknowledge and honor the apparent dead and what those actions be. And they do that normally through rituals and ceremonies. So therefore, the ancestors are kept alive of the various astral planes, you know, until it's time for reincarnation or etc. You know, the title ancestor, however, is reserved for the deceased that were held in high regards while living on earth. Let me put it like this. Someone who dies of an old age from natural causes is held in high regards. You know, they lived a long life. Hopefully, they bestowed a lot of wisdom upon the family bloodline or lineage, you know, so on. Hold on one second.
All right.
Anyway, there's some back noise or interference in the background there. But someone that is highly respected, that follow a defined moral code and passed on, like I said, a code of honor, you know, amongst the family, you know, that's who you want to definitely build this altar for. Someone that had children during their lifetime, who treated the family members well. Of course, there is exceptions, you know, to be made, because in some African traditions, women who are barren, that means who do not have children, sometimes they are not put in that category. But of course, you know, there's exceptions to that rule. Now, anyone that serves as a link also between the living, which is, you know, of course, the material world and the spiritual world, such as a priest, a cultic, mystic, a medium, someone who speaks in tongues, or someone who who's a psychic or prophet, or even who is simply a musical musician. You know, that is something on which that, based on African culture, they definitely would acknowledge that. Now, ancestors are known to do the following. You know, the reason why you set up your altar is for them to help you. So they can act as a medium, you know, which means via your mind, your memories, between you and your higher self, which is, i.e., your God, or your Lord and personal Savior, right? So they also can give protection and act on behalf, you know, of you on the astral plane, and even fight your enemies. You know, this is where the scripture speaks about the fact that I think it's in Ecclesiastes 3:8, where it talks about vengeance is mine, save the Lord, all right? To help determine if the people around you or real friends, or either if they're foes, all right? They can help with that. Also provide perfected insight on matters that has confused you. So if you're confused about a, you know, particular event, situation, you know, in which that has taken place, they can actually help you with that. And I give you a good example of that. I was talking with my class last night, and I was giving some examples, so I'm going to give you all some of the examples, too. Like, for example, my great aunt passed on, and she didn't have any children, but she basically raised me, in a sense. You know, she was one of the eldest women of the family, and I would be over there like every week, you know, and sometimes I would spend the night with her and whatever the case is. And I didn't get a chance to go to a funeral, but right after the funeral, she came within the 3 days and told me that the child on which that I thought was mine, or that I was speculating was mine, actually was not my child, in which that created a ripple effect of me opening a case, in which that was determined that the child was not mine. But she did that from the astral plane, because on that plane, you know, which is called the plane of force, you are able to see much more clearer and understand much more vividly, you know, because you're not confined to just one arena, you know. You're able to go to various places. So therefore, she was able to tell me within just 3 days of her passing that child was not mine. You know, and so, and even though she didn't have any children, obviously she was automatically given amongst the ancestors, because she lived to be over 90 some odd years old. She was already given that ability in order to go amongst the ancestors and be seen as a living relative, you know, in that regard, her ancestral relative, you know. So that is definitely one of the examples. So if you're confused, they can help you with those matters. And also what they can also help is keep you grounded and connected to the family energy. All right. Now, these are basically, I guess you could say, individuals in which that you do not want on your altar. All right. Unless you knew their hearts. You know, and I give you a good example of that too. But normally, people that commit suicide, you know, would not be there based on African tradition. You know, of course, there's always exceptions to the rule, as I was saying. And then, of course, criminal thieves, murderers, liars, etc. Individuals who's non-repentant, don't have any guilt. You know, in other words, like a psychopath or a sociopath, someone who's poor character, promiscuous, you know, a coward, deceitful individual that passed on. You know, young people that died unexpectedly or in tragedies, you know, based on African traditions, per se, because they have not yet got a chance to find their way or to figure things out. Of course, in those particular cases, which I get to in a second, your prayers can actually exalt them to the next level of consciousness. You know, people that die without children, like I said, exceptions. There are exceptions. People that do not display wisdom or any type of spiritual understanding of life. You know, and normally in African tradition, they would say, push back the unworthy. You know, you cannot come to my shrine. You know, like if, for example, a pedophile or a child molester, you know, et cetera, you know, a murderer, unjust murderer, you know. So let me give an example of the criminal, my cousin Tim. He was killed some years ago, all right? He was robbing this man, and a man shot him dead. My mom told me, and I had my altar up, and also I had a picture of him, you know, because we grew up together, and I put him on my altar. And every day, you know, I will call out his name along with the rest of my family line and ancestors, or, you know, gods and goddesses, etc., known and unknown. And within a matter of weeks, my higher self, you know, snatched me from out my body. And I went through this ceremony. And the ceremony was set up like the Soul Train line. Set up like a Soul Train line. And this Soul Train line, you know, it was brothers and sisters dressed in African garb. And Tim was coming up from the right of the Soul Train line. And he was looking bewildered, but in his arms he had African garb. So obviously it was given to him by the ancestors in order to put on, in order for him to join, you know, the ancestors, all right, and no longer be just a dead relative, So the dead relatives can't do anything for you in that regard. It's just like them being a disincarnated shell, you know. And in other words, just memories in which that has no purpose, right? Because that's what we are. We are thought form concentrated in human form. Seven generations on father's side, seven generations on our mother's side. You know, so hence you get the 14 pieces of Osiris, as they say, as well as also the 14 phases of Tahuti. This is what this is all really talking about. You go and do your research and study on ancient Kemetic teaching, in particular, Heru texts. So, as Tim was coming up the middle, they were just clapping and yelling and, you know, shouting, you know, just praising him for being able to join them. And I was like, you know, Tim. And my higher self said, he can't hear you. You know, and so, you know, I'm thinking in my mind, okay, so you snatched me out of my body so I can watch you, but, you know, the nigga can't hear me, and it's because of, you know, me, you know, setting up this altar and, you know, giving, you know, pouring libations, you know, and decreeing and everything every day, and which they're helpful to this. So that was the honor itself, but it was just sad that I couldn't even get the chance to talk to him, you know, in order to find out, you know, what really, you know, happened or, you know, took place. But even then, I was still happy about the fact that I got a chance in order to witness the ceremony. And like I said, as he was coming up, he looked all real nervous and jittery, you know, like he didn't know what was taking place. He didn't know what was going on. But I'm pretty sure they explained it to him after, you know, afterwards. But these are just some of the things in which that, you know, definitely take place when your altar is set up, you know, and you're dealing with, you know, the ancestors. You know, and like I said, their relatives are those that are in the astral world or on the astral plane, and possibly even the lower astral plane, like the first and second overtone, which is where a lot of the negative entities dwell at. You know, they say that's the arena of the fairies and, the gongoros and disincarnated spirits and, or, you know, so-called ghosts and so forth and so on, even extraterrestrials. You know, this is that particular area where they do all that. Allegedly, you know, a lot of negativity. But what happens is that these dead relatives receive no honors. So they receive no praise. There's no poems or sacrifices on their behalf. You know, they're not consulted, nor are they afforded a direct link to the Godhead so that their living relatives can gain divine insight. That's what that is for. You know, even so, these individuals can be prayed for by those family members and friends still living on earth to help strengthen them, you know, while on the lower astral plane, and actually have them to ascend, you know, into higher levels of the astral plane so that they can learn valuable lessons in the astral world, so that when they incarnate again, they incarnate in a better situation, in a much more positive life, all right? Bypassing a lot of those things like we talked about, murder, death, wolf and soul, everything that harms, no longer just trapped within their lower self and the actions and ways and deeds of the lower self or lower nature, right? Of the Set or Soot or Satan. So that's what this is really talking about in that regard. So that's what you want. You want to be in a better life and an environment if you have to incarnate. It's also said that once the ancestors have resolved their guilt-ridden issues on the astral plane, collective ancestors that are called or invoked will allow them into the fold. And that's exactly what happened with my cousin Tom. Now, of course, for those who study Brother Bobby Hemmett, you know, he been told us years ago that when your relative died, they go inside you. And basically, in other words, the ancestors are your DNA or genes. All right, so not only are you strengthening them with the altar, you're strengthening yourself. Okay? Now, there's certain sages or avatars who will have the option to become ancestors that reincarnate on Earth, or even into higher evolutive, you know, planets or dimensions, density levels, realms, etc. Or they become gods that reside permanently in the afterworld. Now, for those that want to reach that level of never having to reincarnate again, then you would develop what's called the golden body, or what is also referred to as the rainbow body. All right? And at that level, you do not have to reincarnate any longer. But I think that you might still have the choice to do so if the need was real necessary. Okay? So these are some of the things that you would want on your altar, on your shrine, and which that consists of the seven elements. Most people only use the four elements, which is earth, air, water, and fire. I go into seven, which that is dealing like, for example, like earth. You know, that means food, coins, such as copper, silver, gold, platinum, etc. Shells, like from out the ocean, magnets, crystals, gems. You know, we have a very good gem selection. I'm on our website, www.dralimelbey.com. Go to the Cultural Freedom Bookstore and check them out. All right, we got the chakra crystals and everything. So that would be what you want as the earth element. The water element, of course, is a glass of water. You know, some use gin, you know, or vodka or rum or etc. But for ancestors that have passed on that had drinking problems, a glass of water it suffices. Water symbolizes astral energy anyway, and it actually gives you the ability, you know, to communicate greater, you know, in that way. As a matter of fact, water is condensed astral energy. All right. Fire, of course, is the next one, in which that, of course, incense and various incense in which that helps with eliminating negativity or evil spirits is frankincense, myrrh, or combined frankincense and myrrh, sandalwood, sage in particular. You can also get bundle sage. You have a very good incense section, as well as also candles. Just we get into the candle magic science. I'm not going to go all the way in on that, but of course, we got the seven spectrums of the rainbow, Roy G. Biv, the colors red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. And how these particular colors, like red, symbolizes energy or strength, power, force. Also sexual energy. Orange symbolizes nurturing. You know, yellow symbolizes intelligence. You know, green symbolizes healing, abundance, success. Blue symbolizes communication. You know, or heightening one's frequency or vibratory rate. Indigo symbolizes psychic abilities, opening and awakening. And violet, white, gold symbolizes the crown chakra, which symbolizes the highest acts of spirituality in human form. So, spiritual centers, awakening. All right, so candle magic goes into those sciences. And of course, the candles could be used to enhance health, protection, prosperity, or spiritual blessings. Now, then of course you have air. And like I said, that's incense. Because released from the burning of the incense, the smoke. Smoke symbolizes that air. All right, as well as also your speech, because the average person breathes about 3 cubic feet per second. You know, an individual can actually take in, a breath of compressed air, about 15 pounds per cubic inch, heat it, and then blow it out. So your breath of life itself symbolizes that air aspect, in which that taps into that sound or ether aspect, the powers of words. And then when you put it into a rhythm or a cadence, symbolizes power, And we know that sound travels at a rate of 1,120 feet per second. So, and sound is nothing more than downgraded light. Light travels at 186,000 miles per second, which is downgraded from thought, which travels at 24 billion miles per second. So, we're talking about sound, light, and thought. So those three symbolizes the three higher aspects of what you're doing with your altar or shrine. So those are the seven elements. All right. Now, thought is very important. Sound, light, and thought is very important because, like I said, the voice is dealing with the sounds. The light itself is attuning yourself properly. Your third eye, which is your first eye, you attune it properly so that as you are saying your words, you're actually feeling the sensation in between your eyes, up above your eyebrows, and you're feeling a sensation in that area, in which that when you use the power of thought, your intentions, affirmations, prayers, decrees, or frequencies, which means the how often you repeat a thing, and then, of course, how much you feel it, your feelings come into play. That's your soul, your body, which that comes into play with that. And when you have all these things together, it symbolizes a manifestation, all right? And so your thoughts, you will want a picture in order to help with the thoughts of your ancestors that have passed on your altar, all right? The Magi is concentrated on the problem or question, and then stares. Now, this is where you get into mirror magic, too, or shrine, right? And in this mirror magic, the Magi concentrate on the, getting a solution to the problem. They can stare into the mirror from which that they receive an image, and that can also be part of that whole process, right? So, these are the seven areas, elements that we can definitely get into, with the setting up of the altar. All right. Now, let me just say this, is that the names of biblical prophets or et cetera can be culturally exchanged or replaced because they have fictional characters. All right. In other words, the Jews has transformed in some instances living or people who have actually lived, they are still a thought form, but there was a living thought form, but who have passed on, transformed, left their body, and then they have transformed and changed the names and have given it their belief system and have transformed these people in some regards to becoming just a mere thought form of something in which that actually never existed. For example, what I'm talking about is that Akhenaten, who was the pharaoh and the ghoul of the 18th dynasty, he ruled during that time period of the 18th dynasty. But your Bible speaks about a David. Okay? Akhenaten had a son by the name of Tutankhamun, or King Tut. And David had a son by the name of Solomon. All right? Now, David and Solomon, King David, King Solomon, are made up based off of those who actually existed, which is Akhenaten, or Akhenaten, and Tutankhamun, or King Tut. All right? Now, the fact that they actually lived means that they can bear witness to the frailties, the situations with the physical body, mind, temptations, events, problems, in which that is here in his flesh. But the fact that King David and King Solomon never had fleshly bodies means that if you acknowledge them on your altar, then they cannot sympathize or empathize with your plight as being a human being, because they never had physical bodies. Okay? So this is the key of what we're trying to make you understand. All right? Now, on your altars, there's various sacred items that you're going to have there. You're going to have sigils, which is pictures, symbols, or empowering objects, you know, such as, etc., which can actually be utilized to enhance the communication between the physical and the spiritual realm. As well as, you know, also pictures, like you said, candles, water, shells, mirror, barrels, etc. Now, there's a good book. This book is called The Akhen Protocol. The Akhen Protocol, Remembering the Traditions of Our Ancestors. It's written by my man, Nana Akua Opakua. All right? Once again, it's called The Akhen Protocol, Remembering the Traditions of Our Ancestors. Now, if you go to our website and go to the section where, for the Hall of Knowledge, we have crazy occult books and, you know, PDFs and so forth and so on. I mean, esoteric teachings and coming from all these schools of thoughts, African traditions also, in which that breaks down this information. And the PDFs are simply $10, you know. So you can go there and get this information. But in the Akhen Protocol, it says the ancestral altar allows us to establish that communication with our personal ancestors in a real way. We can touch the altar and feel the presence of our ancestors while we sit there and talk there. It is our very connection to those ancestors who can help us decease relatives and construct altars in their homes containing photographs of their ancestors. All right. So thus, in times of celebration or crisis, a person can offer thanks and calls to his or her ancestors for guidance, help, and, you know, blissfulness. You don't say blessings, because remember, blessings based on Oxford Dictionary means blessed sacrifice. And sometimes, of course, you know, in African traditions or religions, they are blessed sacrifices, regardless if you're coming from the Congo Rites or Palo Mayombe or the various Palos, as well as the Ifa, the Akhen, the Yoruba traditions, the Wudan, you know, Santeria, or etc. But they all practice, you know, ancestral acknowledgments in this regard. They call it ancestral worship. Ancestral worship is actually worshiping yourself. All right? Now, people that are connected to their ancestors want to learn how to master and open their third eye, first eye, to receive messages from the spiritual world about life choices. Remember, your third eye is your mind's eye. Thus, you do not have to make any decision without first being properly guided. All right, and there's other tools that you can use with that tarot card reading, psychic evaluation, or whatever the case is, or astrology, numerology. Those are tools. Your altar is a tool, all right, and I'm going to get to that in a second. All right, but when you have your altar, you never feel alone. Therefore, you're less likely to be sad or depressed. You get along better with your living family members, you know, and are actually protected better against strangers and those with harmful intent. You know, so when you acknowledge your ancestors, be sure that you call on, like I said, the seven generations on your mother's side and the seven generations on your father's side. The critical factor in almost anyone's life is the degree to which that ego defines their spiritual strives towards unification with the higher self. Unfortunately, education, especially nowadays, forces the mind strictly towards materialistic goals, thereby divorcing instructions on true religion, which is spirituality, from the educational curriculum. And religions are simply now degraded spiritual systems that were derived from, you know, Kush, ancient Kemet, all right, or what is called Tamaray. Now, at most introduction to comparative religious studies, the basis of religion has to be related to the anatomy of man, woman, and therefore is scientific as any other principle. Otherwise, it's not a true religion. So if you're dealing with religions in which that don't teach you the science on how to apply this information back to the human body, then it's not a true religion. That's a false religion. That's a fallacy. Okay? So y'all have to understand that in these particular sciences here, you know? And you also have to understand the difference between high magic and low magic. Your altar is there not only for you to communicate with your ancestors, but for your ancestors to be able to work between the realms of high magic and low magic on your behalf. And what I mean by that is that high magic, which is ultimately designed to change the person, remember, the ancestors dwell within you, so by you praising them, they change you. The energy changes within you, all right? And being that you're giving energy, you're taking in energy simultaneously. It's a give and take, or give and receive. So ultimately, it's designed to change the person. That's what high magic is there to do, is to change the person. And that alters the manifest reality. It's involved the science of alchemy, or internal alchemy particularly. In other words, high magic deals with moving the kundalini from the base chakra up through the Roy G. Biv or the rainbow spectrums, which you would use for the candles externally. It is done internally. So high magic, you know, does not typically manifest things except for a greater awareness of consciousness. You know what I'm saying? So it manifests the changes within one's own inner reality, and thus changing the outer apparent reality. All right, said illusion. Now in Shechem Ursh Shechem Raon Nefer Amen, the author of course, some of the most fantastic books you can get, the Metu Neta. And right now I think he's up to six, but he said if you're not cultivating and manifesting the unifying self-image of Godhead within you, but instead you're cultivating and manifesting your persona, then you are a worshiper of a demigod in the nonsense of Western theology and the theologians. This is what he's saying. So that's when you become a demigod or worshiper, is when you're not understanding this information is dealing with the human body and the principles in which that is occurring and taking place in the human body. That's high magic. Now, low magic, that's designed to change the apparent reality, the illusion or the matrix, you know, through multiple methods, all right? That's like the movie Matrix. That's what that was based on. That was low magic. You know, it appeared to be high magic, but actually it was low magic, because typically a low magical working attempts to overpower existing manifestations and thus makes the desired manifestation happen instead. So it's like it's a lot like jamming a radio or a TV station so that you can put your own signal on top of it. Go back and watch the movie They Live. You will see that they had the TV on in which that was programming and mind controlling the people, and then they will come in, the resistance will come in and put their own signal over top of it and jam the signal. All right? So low magic can be quite effective, but since it usually only overpowers the normal manifest reality, it is at best temporary. We don't want temporary results. Now, I'm not saying that you can't use low magic. I'm just saying that the ultimate end is you working towards high magic, which is your higher self, and not keep utilizing low magic, which is dealing with your lower self. Remember, everything in the personality already is against the desired manifestation. Otherwise, it would exist without the need for additional work. So the establishment, schools, churches, etc., do not want you to study the so-called sciences, you know, such as astrology, numerology, tarot, you know, mythology, sciences, you know, they call them pseudosciences. And they tell you to stay away from it, that they're devilishment, you know, that they're of the devil. And they tell you this because they don't want you to begin your journey towards your higher self. But before you do, you need some tools. And the lower self or the lower magic is where these tools are located at, such as astrology, numerology, tarot, or etc. This is where you are able to utilize the left hemisphere of your brain, because your left hemisphere of your brain needs something tangible. All right? Your right hemisphere of your brain do not, is abstract. But in order for them to synchronize, you must have something tangible, physical. In other words, that can be sensed with your five senses, taste, smell, hearing. But you also must understand that the right hemisphere of the brain with the electrifying of the 12 pair of cranial nerves in your brain give you access to the higher senses, or what's called extrasensory perception, or ESP. So for touch, you have psychemistry. For sight, you have clairvoyance. For hearing, you have audience. For smell, you have a clear sentient. For taste, you have clear gustance. So these are five higher senses of the five normal senses that you use. But yet, actually, there's only one sense, and that's feeling. Everything deals with vibratory rate of feeling. In other words, with your soul development, because in order to feel, you must have a soul. This is the difference between the so-called cutthroat reptilians, those who use only the reptilian portion of their brain, and those who use the neo-mammal portion of the brain. The neo-mammal portion of the brain deals with the development of a soul. In other words, the activation of the pineal gland, in which that is the seat of the soul, and the soul is embedded inside of the pineal gland. The activation of that soul principle comes by way of mastering your feelings, your emotions, energy and motion. All right? This is why they tell men that, you know, you're supposed to cry. And they gave us that theology of being rough, tough, and hard to bluff, you know, type of mentality. And that's become a detriment to us. And that has even began to shut the women down in that regard. So now we have a world in which that we look around in which that has less soul. At one time, we was the soul people. Even in the nastiest food we ate was called soul food. Chitlins. Oh, mom. Pig ears. Pig tails. Chicken feet. Shit. Turkey neck. Blood pudding. God damn, shit. Every damn thing the nigga ate. Shit. Everything the nigga ate was was said to be soul food. But even then, it appeared that we had more soul then when we was eating it than most of you niggas who claim to be vegetarian now. And that's a shame. Is what is going on. We're talking about soul development here. And the soul development comes by way of the manipulation of the higher senses in the brain, the 12 pair of cranial nerves, the pineal gland, the pituitary gland, the hypothalamus gland, the thalamus gland, tapping into the neo mammal, which is the word neo means new. And this is the reason why Neo was called Neo on the movie Matrix, because he represented tapping into that new portion of the brain. Not the old brain, which is the primal brain, brainstem, which is called the reptilian brain, which is, sits directly up from the spinal column, right below the medulla oblongata. Even though that particular brain has 12 sites also, which is called the melanin centers, only two of those sites within the Europeans is activated. Get Nutricize and Afro and African Holistic Health by Dr. Leia Africa. He breaks the information down on that. I break it down in my book, First World Order. For those who want it, you need to get it. If you ain't got it, the 7 chapters of the most dynamic information you ever find on this damn planet. And that's Dr. Alim El-Bey website, once again, www.dralimelbay.com. All right? We got a new book out. It's called Is Benjamin Banneker Prince Hall? As I said, niggas over the years have stole my information. I came out, and anyone who know me, back in the late 1990s. All right? And was teaching it already. But as we know, since the spirit is the one who revealed that information, I'm the one in which is going to have to put the book together in order to, for it to make sense, instead of just people just floating around spouting it and can't explain it. So in this new book, that's what we do. We explain it. So that book is out right now. So that is also on the website. Check it out, www.dralimelbay.com. So we get ready to go to the lines right quick. Let me go here. All right, at area code 859, you're on the line. Peace.
Peace. Greetings, Dr. Ling. This is Sister Tamaray. I had a quick question for you.
Yes.
Give me just a second. Let me, the volume's acting up on my phone. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
I know you were, noticed you were talking about the Matrix earlier.
Right.
In regards to the different centers in your brain and detaching from the matrix. And I was just wondering, I was in meditation the other morning, and I felt like a really, really intense, I guess, tingling sensations, like right above the base of my head, like right kind of at the space where there was that plug in the Matrix movie. And I was just wondering if you had any insight on that.
Yeah, oftentimes what happens is that the kundalini is activated, and being that you was meditating, it probably was activated a little bit more than normal, because normally within the individual, it's only activated by 10%. The other 90% of the kundalini goes unused between the person's whole entire life, unless they activate it through various forms of meditation, breathing exercises, or tantric yoga. You know, so while you was meditating, the kundalini became more active than just 10%, and it did hit the medulla oblongata. And oftentimes, when it strikes in that area, it's called the axe. Matter of fact, do your research or study on Hebrew, you will see that a gulp, Q-O-P-H, on which that has symbols in 8. It has the symbol of 8. It has the symbol of an axe, which, well, a monkey, an axe. It has the symbol of what appears to look like a, you know, what is it? It's copy. It's talking about that the medulla oblongata is a copy, is the copying center of the body. That is where your past lives are located at. That is where your photographic memory is located at. So when the kundalini hits that area, it sounds like a thump. All right, like a axe hitting a block of wood, you know, when it's in full power, full gauge. But yours wasn't necessarily in full gauge at that point, but you was meditating, and so it gave off those sensations, you know, as if an axe was hitting a piece of wood. So that is actually what was taking place with you. What I can tell you is that you want to continue meditating, but you want to do like we do in the microcosmic orbit technique for the sisters. You want to actually absorb the energy and put the energy into your dantian, your lower dantian, which is right at your navel, right below your navel chakra. And that's where you want to store the energy at when you breathe in. And as you breathe out, you'll store the energy there. You'll pull the energy up the front channel of your body, called your conceptual vessel. And then you can link down, not up, but down the back of your spine, the center of your spine, called, you know, in your shoshuna, that's where you're going to send that prana at, is down it. And you want to bring it back up and circulate it, you know, up and down in that manner. So that is the difference in which that women will have to do it. And that is the microcosmic orbit technique in which they keep the women feminized and not masculine in objectives. All right, so that's really what that is talking, you know, really talking about actually what, you know, transpired within.
Okay, well,
can you hear me?
Thank you. I can hear you. Yeah, thanks. That answered it, because it was, yeah, it hurt. It was, you know, it wasn't a good feeling. So I will, when I do my next meditation, I will make sure that I store that energy in my dantian.
Right. Bring it up the front channel, the frontal channel, what is called the conceptual channel. And then down the back, down the governing channel, back to the perineum, which is around the G-spot area, which is about an inch and a half to 3 inches inside of the vaginal area, and then back up, again.
You're going out.
And that opens up your channels.
Okay.
Okay. That will open up your channel.
And back down the spine and circulate
right.
Up and down.
Okay. Right. Of course, see, literally bring the energy up towards the medulla oblongata at the back of the head and send it down the front. But women does it in the opposite way in order to keep, your feminine and keep us masculine so that we can be a balance of force with each other.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you.
All right. All right, we got area code 202-202. You're on the line.
Please.
How you doing?
I'm good. I just want to say, first of all, thank you so much for just bringing tonight. Based on what you said, I'm definitely going to enhance my altar. Like, I was listening to you, I've found like so many other things that I can, you know, so many other additions.
So many additions.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome.
And then also, Nana Aquia is definitely
right.
A woman's name. I think that's a woman. I refer to her as a man.
Say it again.
Nana Aquia, the author of the book you mentioned tonight.
Yeah, but it wasn't a. It wasn't a sister. Let me go back here. It wasn't a sister's name. Let me see if I can get his name again here. Okupua. It's Okupua.
Right, but before that, isn't it Akuya? A-K-U-A?
No, I don't think so, no. Let's see. Yeah, it's spelled A-K-U-A-O-P-O-K-U-W-A-A.
But yeah, Aquia is a female name. That's a woman.
Right.
But that's not Aquia.
But it was a brother that was on the cover. That's the reason why I said that. So I don't know. It could have been a combination, you know, I guess, or I might have forgot another author here. You know, because
they forgot it on the book.
You know, because it's been years since I read this book. This book, shoot, I read this book, I think, back in 95, 96. Hmm. Okay, but I spelled it, so for those who want to go and check it out, N-A-N-A-A-K-U-A-O-P-O. K-U-W-A-A. Okay? All right. For those who want to call in at 626-414-3535. That's 626-414-3535. Call in. Brother L?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you got anything you want to add?
Yes, I was listening to you what you said earlier about the higher magic and the lower magic, and I was saying that was dealing with the white and black magic, also what they people
right.
Some people referring to.
Right, what they think that's right. Mm-hmm.
And I know there's some people say that there's no such thing as white or black magic. In that sense, you know, that makes sense also, but I still stress the white magic and the black magic. Yes, I still stress those because that'd be a definition between the two forces or energies that we are putting out there. And also, I'm looking forward to seeing your book of the Benjamin Banneker and Prince Hall.
Right, right.
Been having
appreciate
a lot of debate with a lot of brothers, especially Prince Hall Masons, about that subject.
Right. Right. All right.
Can you hear me okay?
Oh, yeah, I hear you perfectly, bro. You perfectly.
Okay. Okay.
All right. Being that we talking about the candle magic and, you know, we want to go over that information, too. Like we were saying, red, also brings love, passion into the light. Red is also used for health and vitality, courage and protection. Red is also associated with the elements of fire, so it can be very forceful, you know what I'm saying? So you have to use it cautiously, you know, and too much red can actually end up burning you up in a sense, you know.
Yeah.
But red can be definitely used, and of course, if you get white, you know, white is for all purpose. You know, if anything else fails, you can use white. You know, white contains, the various colors. You know, white is also used for protection. And it's very, effective as far as reflecting negativity.
Mm-hmm.
And when you combine white and red, you know, you get the color pink. And pink is, with love, friendship, romance, and particularly, pink can be used for self-love.
You know,
and then, of course, orange, which deals with attraction and energy. Orange is usually used to enhance another candle for the more advanced working, in which that, you start going into gold. But yellow, is, like I said, was for intelligence, but it's also used for mental energies, confidence, communication also. Yellow can help studying, in school, yellow is the element of air, so everything mental. And green is good, like I said, for prosperity, money, fertility, healing, growth. If you need money or a new job, green is the candle of the choice, Then you have blue, which brings peace, healing, patience, happiness, psychic attunement. It helps with relaxation. And being that it's associated with water, it helps with emotional balance, purple, which is a form of violet, is real powerful. It deals with healing of severe diseases, spirituality, meditations, used to enhance all type of spiritual workings, used in combination with the blue candle for intense healing. Brown can also be used. That color brown is good for grounding, and it can also be used for work with animals, especially when it's combined with other colors. Gray, which is silver, can deal with psychic development, and also can be dealing with advanced work. And even black, absorbs negativity, banishes negativity, and black can be used to help get rid of, harmful things, in your environment,
All right.
Yeah. So, these are the basic colors that you'll find, and the science is that you can also understand the power of songs. My wife and I have a book called The 11 Powers of Songs, in which that we break down the fact that Psalms is actually Amenhotep III and Amenhotep IV, who was known as Ankh-Anten, also referred to as Tutankhamun, well, Akhenaten, the father of Tutankhamun, that actually he's the one who wrote Psalms, Proverbs, you know, in the Songs of Solomon, and, you know, all these particular books that is in the Bible actually came from ancient Egypt. And even as E.A. Wallace Budge broke down, these are books in which that is spell books. All right. And the ancient Egyptians understood the power of Hakul and Hesi, you know, words of power and repetition of being able to put a thought, embed a conscious thought into the subconscious mind. They understood that. So the two, that candles can be utilized in order to help with that manifestation, because when you touch a candle, all right, you leave an auric residue on that candle. So that means the last thought impression that you leave on the candle, once you light it, it burns to that thought, to that impression. All right. So if it's a 7-day candle, and that's what we recommend, you can go to the website and you'll see the various 7-day candles that we have, all the colors on which that we made mention of, that we explained, you know, and much more. You know, so there's also oils in which that can be utilized, in which that correlates, can be utilized, in which that helps correlate and strengthen the ritual or the ceremony. Most of the time, you will start out with your zodiac sign, all right, as the criteria, you know, and gain an understanding of who you are, because in the frequency that you came here to planet Earth with and on, and therefore you can begin from that particular vector, from that particular power sector of yourself. You know, that, I mean, really, everything begins with you, you know. So by you understanding these particular sciences, tools to utilize, you take yourself into a whole different conscious arena. And of course, some people are scared, but yet when you go to the Old Testament, they burn incense, they have altars set up. Matter of fact, they even do sacrifices, animal sacrifices in particular, of goat, ram, sheep, even cow, even attempted human being. Isaac was put on the altar by Abraham. So, you know, Christians, please don't act like you never heard of any of this when your whole Old Testament is based on it. You know, your whole Old Testament is based on African religious traditions, customs, ritual. That's all it is. Until the Jews took it and they put their little spin on it in order to state that they have a history. All right. And of course, you know, that comes after the burning of Jerusalem, 70 AD, with the conversion of the Khazars, Russian, you know, into Judaism. Because the original Jews or Judaism, who I should say, were the followers of Jehuti or Tahuti. That's where the word Jew come from. Later on, the religion called Judaism. Okay? So, we're talking really about an African religion. And even if you get the wonderful Ethiopian Empire, Kushite Empire of Ethiopia by Drusilla Houston Dungey. When you get her book, she tells you that the ancient priesthood of Egypt was actually Ethiopian. It was Kushite priests. That's who ran the Egyptian priesthood. So we now will refer to them as the Falashans. All right? Within Ethiopia, they would be the Coptic priesthood. all right, in which that, what formed later on was the Vatican from out of that, went in order to get the information of the ancient mystery school of Egypt and to consolidate it. And they did that through Alexandria Library, where the most profound minds in the world at that time would come and gather, write books, and these books would be within this library, in which they ended up with 700,000 books, over 700,000 books. Allegedly, this library burnt, but yet there's about 200,000 of these books still, or books, tablets, clay, brick, you know, writings, is still found at the bottom of the basement of the Vatican, hid behind 2 feet of steel doors with armed guards. Okay? So, this is actually what's going on. Let me go back and see what's going on. Once again, for those who have questions, hit us up at 626-414-3535. That's 626-414-3535. Hit us up. All right, Brother L, you with me?
Yeah.
All right, all right.
Yeah.
Anything particular that you want to join?
Yes. I was, again, back to the candles and the different colors of the candles. And they send out different energies as dealing with us.
Right. Matter of fact, your candle, you know, when you touch it, now your candle is charged with your own personal energy and your own magical intent.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Different for the different kundalini chakras that we deal with every day, really.
Mm-hmm.
And I was listening also about our relatives that passed away or passed in transition, as we may say. Sometimes I look at the portrait or the picture of my great-great-grandmother.
Right.
And she, which is, we all know she was Choctaw or Washita. And sometimes I want to go to bed, go to sleep, and when I look at the picture, and it seems like it tells me, she's telling me to go on, keep on reading, keep on studying. So sometimes I don't go to bed right away, you know. And I know that's the energy that she's passing on to me. Like you said earlier, when they die, a lot of their energy pass on to us, to go inside us.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah, so.
And yeah, another thing, too, is that when we're talking about the ancestors going inside of us, that means they become part of your template, your frequency in which that you was born on. So hence your zodiac sign. And like for Aries, a good color for Aries is red. For Tauruses is green. For Gemini is yellow. For Cancer is silver. For Leo is orange. For Virgo is yellow. For Libra is pink. For Scorpio is red. For Sagittarius is purple. For Capricorn, black. For Aquarius, all colors. And Pisces, mauve. You know, so those are the colors of the candles in which that can be utilized in order to increase the zodiacal sign, hence their own personal life force energy that they were born on.
All right. Yes, that's why we stay in tune with those chakras, especially when we're doing our breathing exercises and meditating, you know, concentration on all the chakras, all the way to the crown chakra, which is, you said earlier, the gold chakra.
That's right.
Which is the gold of the sun, or the sun rays, which give its energy to gold, where gold gets its energy from.
Right. Exactly.
And also, the white, which means purity, as dealing with the moon sometimes, as dealing with the silver, the energy of where silver gets its energy from also.
Mm-hmm.
From
the right.
Moon.
The moon, feminine energy, right.
Right. And the white means God, ruler of the earth. And
right.
Those colors goes a lot deeper than a lot of people realize. You kind of get them to not to say that call themselves black or anything like that, because you know you can read in the Black Law Dictionary what it tells you what it means. Definitely, what it means. It means dead in view of the law, and the white is means divine, divinity. And, you know, like I just said before, God and ruler of the earth land. And this is also, this could mean us, you know, as a group of people, not some physical group of people dealing with
right.
The pigmentation of their skin.
Right, the white brotherhood, right, in which that comes from Sirius, you know,
yeah.
In which that the Dogon speaks about Sirius, so. When they speak about it, you know, they couldn't possibly have been talking about, you know, white people, you know, because they say that our ancestors or our DNA is derived from the configuration of Sirius A and Sirius B, you know, which is that pattern, which is the exact same pattern as our DNA, which is also the same exact pattern as our Kundalini rising or descended. So, we know this is what they were really talking about, and they talk about the original people on the planet Earth, the indigenous
yeah.
people, the Africans, you know what I'm saying? So this is what they really was talking about, you know? So, you know, we know they couldn't have been talking about no white brotherhood in the sense of white people. They're talking about purity, like you said, in that sense.
Yeah.
Hold on, brother. Let me go to the phone line. We got area code 440-440. You're on the line.
How you doing, Dr. Alim?
Right. Well, bro, what's up with you?
Well, I got a quick question about an experience I had. Like I was meditating. I normally meditate before I go to sleep. And like I have these prophetic dreams. And I was just trying to learn how to do prayer, you know, like turn them on, not turn them on and off, but basically, you know, control when I want to see stuff. And I went to sleep, and I had this dream, this really, really loud popping sound, like where my third eye is, and it was like it sounded like electricity sizzle. And then,
right.
like, immediately after that, it was a portal that opened on a door. And,
mm-hmm.
you know, I tried to walk towards the door, but I couldn't get through it. That next day, all day long, I saw rainbows. And I kept getting this it was something. I'm not sure what it was, but I kept feeling like Kim Dial, from the Thor movie.
Right, I got you.
Can you explain to me what's going on?
I mean, truthfully, it sounds like what happened actually happened. What I mean by that is that there's times in which that you do hear crackling in your brain area because of the firing off of the synapses and the dendrites, which, you know, bring you into different areas of the brain, in particular brain area in which that is not being used, you know, in this particular lifetime. So what you did, being that you've been able to meditate, you've been able to go into new arenas of the brain, and they did open a portal. There's this particular portal ways within your brain. And you open up one of those particular portals. That's the same thing within the movie Matrix when they have all them damn doors. Those doors symbolizes those 50 portals or ways in which that is on the tree of life, which is symbolic to your chakra system. and your physical body, you know, your energy centers, your nadis and your meridians, your channels, or what they ever want, you know, whatever they want to refer to it at. So all of that is symbolic, to actually you being able to go and look into different dimensions. You have that gift.
That makes so much sense.
Like the tree pole.
Got you. Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, thanks for clearing that up.
Well, you're welcome, brother. All right, we got area code once again, 626-414-3535. Call in, get a question in. All right, check us out, 626-414-3535.
All right. Yeah. Yes, I was saying earlier, Aline, I was getting ready to go to bed, and I was reading this book, and my great-grandmother, I looked at my great-grandmother's picture, and it sounded like she said to me, don't you dare go to bed right now.
Right.
Keep reading that book.
Keep reading
that
book. Exactly. And those things happen. Ancestors around, especially when we have pictures and altars and things set up to them, and we think about them often, being that they go inside of us, there's always an instant connection in which that can take place. They can hear your voice. In other words, your cellular, your molecular, your atomic, subatomic voice, echoing, in the distance to them. And these frequencies can be picked up and can be, connected via mentally, because you know that even though you have a brain and the brain is in your head, but thought exists throughout your whole cellular structure. All 76 trillion cells in your body possess thought. And how we know that? Because we can take a speck of blood, a strand of hair, a speck of spittle, and clone a whole nother you in existence. That means that your whole human body template is a hologram. It's holographic.
Right.
And the only thing in which that is not a hologram within you is your soul. But the physical body itself is a hologram. Its template is a hologram. And so by even the science of cloning shows that this incarnation in which that can occur, over and over again. Because if man claims that he can clone, then you also have to make the assumption that incarnation has to exist, because those particles still exist even after the death of the human body. These are things in which that people have to become aware of. On their travels.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. The holographic.
Holographic Memory by Michael Talbot.
Something by Michael Talbot.
Right. You can get the book Holographic Memory. Holographic Universe by Michael Talbot. Book that came out during the early to mid 90s.
Yes, I was watching the movie with Kurt Russell. It was dealing with the return. It was in Los Angeles. But it was a sequel to Escape from New York, and they deal with that, they use holographic techniques to fool certain people. I don't know if you saw the movie or not, but and they thought they had killed him, but they didn't. They were shooting at the holographic
image
image of him.
Right.
And that's how he tricked the six people. That's how it got to him.
Mm-hmm.
But I really advise a lot of the Moors to really check that movie out when it comes back on TV, television.
Give them the name again, brother.
It's called Escape in Los Angeles. It was Kurt Russell. And, but it wasn't Escape from New York. It was a movie made back in, I believe, in the late 90s or early 2000s.
I can't remember quite.
And it was he was captured, and what they had thought it was him wasn't him, and they had thought they had shot him up, but they shot up the image of him, and they had put a lot of that out in that movie, a lot of holographic, a lot of that in that movie.
Right. All right, yeah, we definitely got to check that out, fam.
Right.
So make sure go and check that out, Escape from L.A., all right?
Yeah, that's what it was. I think it was from L.A. One from North New York this time. The first one, that was back in the 70s, I believe, with Escape from New York.
Right.
This one was Escape from L.A.
Right, exactly. So y'all go and check that out if y'all haven't seen it in a minute. Be good to rekindle that and, see what's going on. I'm going to get back to these candles real quick.
Okay.
What we was talking about earlier is that you can dress your candle. If you're not using a 7-day glass candle and you're using a candle outside of glass, you can dress it. You can use oils, various oils, as we may mention of. You know, sage oil is excellent, as well as frankincense, myrrh, patchouli, sandalwood. These are normally the protective oils from negativity, all right? But the science of the flames, let's get into the meaning of the flames and what happens. All right? Like, for example, if you have a dancing flame, the flame is just dancing all over the place and there's no draft in the room or whatever the case is, what that does is it determines how your magic is going to progress. If it's dancing real nice, then your magic is working good, real well. All right, if there's a strong flame, that indicates that there's power and energy that's going into your desires to manifest. That's a very good sign, you know. So, matter of fact, if you have high flame, it represents authority over another. You know, because that means someone might have been possibly failed to you, but your magic is stronger. All right. The weak flame, means that there's heavy opposition and you must redo the magic, several times in order to overcome the power that you're facing. You know?
Mm-hmm.
If the flame is, constantly weak, that means the subject is basically losing the battle. You know what I'm saying? Against the magic. You know? If the flame is jumping, that goes back, good sign for success, that, something, is getting ready to manifest for you. Smoke, coming from the flame once it's lit, symbolizes, in case of health, it can mean condition can get worse, or careful to review a situation, or if it's going towards the north, that's what it would mean. If it's going towards the south, things of health, it says your recovery is imminent, there's times when you have talking candles, once you lit it, it makes a lot of crackling noise.
Oh, right.
Makes a lot of crackling noise. And, what that means is that, what has been told, if it's soft, it indicates, intimate conversations. I'm talking about pure thought, if it's mild, towards the position of authority, you've given orders or directions. If it's strong, then it could be symbolic to argument, arguments or quarrels or et cetera. Remember, the language of the candle is important. So you definitely want to pay attention to that. And sometimes, based on the amount of energy that you put into the candle, which is your auric residue, it cracks, or crackle, I should say, that sound, because what you have done is working. All right. So also, if you burn a candle and the bottom half of the glass is black, it symbolizes prosperity, protection, lucky candle. In that sense, negativity was sent your way, and the candle detected it. Okay. If the candle only burns to one side, it could mean that the candle dressing was wrongly used. It wasn't used, in other words, with the best intent. If the glass cracks or break, if you use a 7-day candle, that means witchcraft or presence of secret enemies, are there, And if the candle, is being used in order to protect yourself, prior to you knowing it, and there is nothing else going on outside of that, it basically means that there's protection for you, So irregardless, it deals with protection. If the candle, like I was saying with the crackle too, I meant to say this, is that the crackle noise, the candle is for self-protection. If it's for self-protection, it means that someone is talking about you or have bad intentions directed towards you. But if it's being used for protection, then that means that the individual was thinking about you. All right, so that's what the crackling sound also symbolizes too. If the candle flickers, it symbolizes the presence of spirits. All right, if it flickers, that's what it symbolizes. If the candle have more than one flame, if you're using the candle for self-protection, then and it has more than one flame, the center portion of that represents an enemy. If the candle is being used to dump, basically for protection or protective reasonings, the individual is being helped by other people. In other words, they're not doing it themselves. They're getting some outside work done. All right, so I want to break that information down to y'all for the signs of candle magic, and get ready to call it a night here. So for those who still have questions, you better call now. That's 626-414-3535. If not, we get ready to head out, and we're going to see y'all Friday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. All right. Brother L, you got any closing remarks?
Yes, I'm so glad to talk to you again on the Blog Talk Show tonight, the First World Order and everything. And I've sent all my energies and everything out to you and the goddess. And much love, peace and love to both of you.
No doubt. Appreciate that. Peace and love to you, God. And we appreciate you for coming on and, handling things. And we got a quick. We got area code 920. 920, you're on the line.
How you brothers doing?
Very well. Good, well.
Okay, I have a question with a dream I had a couple months ago. And in this dream, it was like a square, but it had psychedelic colors in it. And it had like a ringing type of sound to it, and I was gauging it to it, like as it the sound got a little louder, and I was approaching to get closer to it, and I was like feeling like this body bug along with it. Could you explain that to me?
Yeah, well, it's real simple, brother. You ever heard of Mandela's? Or Mandela's?
No, I haven't.
These are objects, just like what you talked about, whether squares or circles or what are the geometrical shapes in which that has images in which that emits from it. And actually, like you said, by staring at them, they open and activate certain centers in the brain.
Okay.
All right?
Okay.
Yeah, so actually what you actually tapped into was a archetype, a symbol archetype, obviously part of your ancestral line. And if you can draw it, that will help you tap into these areas during meditations when it's necessary.
You said if I draw it,
Right. You have to go back in your mind and draw it. You said it was red. You said it had a red sound to it, a ring of sound to it, right?
Right.
All right. Oftentimes when you hear ringing or tones or sounds, you're going into the astral plane, brother.
Okay.
This is why upon death or when a person is about to faint or pass out, they hear ringing in the ears. The ringing in the ears is actually the attunement actually from the kidneys, in which that is ancestral attunement, in which that is preparing you for the frequency for out of body, whether it's near-death experience or whether it's actual death experience. So anytime that you hear sound, it means that it's astral in origin. But that's where music comes from. Music is astral. The ethers permeate music or sound or frequency or vibratory rate. And we are a condensation of that energy.
Wow.
Okay?
All right.
All right, brother.
Okay.
Appreciate you. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks.
Peace.
First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air. No doubt.
All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday is 8 o'clock. We are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the room based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance.
Order.
System regulates to bring about specifics in the room based on value and natural characteristics.
Radio.
Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.